Thank you for tuning in to another episode of Healthy Soul with Coach T. Today I want to talk about the unexpected guest. Have you ever been invited to a party or to an event by someone, and when you got there, you were having a pretty good time at the party, at the event, and then you look around and you see all the guests that are at the party and things are going well, and then a couple of people may walk in that just does not look like the guest list? Yeah, I think some of us have been there. And so you take it upon yourself, because of the type of person that you are, you want to make everyone feel welcome. You want to make everyone feel like they belong. And so you go over to talk to the individual, to welcome them, to just kind of make them feel invited to the party. Lo and behold, after you do that, you end up catching the kickback from the party host, because the person who was unexpected, who was uninvited, does not fit the, let's just say, the avatar, as we say in coaching. They're not the ideal person for that particular party. And so you get the kickback as to why you went over and had conversation. Why did you go over and talk to them? Why did you do that? And you know that you did it because, you know, you want people to feel welcome. And this person came in and you could sense that they felt a little unsure. They were hurt. They were broken. And you wanted to make them to feel welcome, to know that they are valued, and that was your purpose. And so today on my show, I have a very special guest. This individual has been my pastor for many years. He and his wife pastored me for about 13 years, actually. And they are now the senior pastors of the Glorious Church of Raleigh. I just can't say enough great things about them. I won't even do it because I know it makes him uncomfortable, but here's what you need to know. He and his wife, they love the Lord, and he is an amazing leader. He is an amazing coach. He's been an amazing mentor, and he's been a consistent voice in my life. And as a matter of fact, I believe that the reason that I am on the air today is because since I moved back to North Carolina 4 years ago, he has been one of the voices, has been the voice, actually, who has constantly spoken to my life that he could see me being on the air or on television. So I want to introduce to my listeners today Pastor Darrell Davis, who is the senior pastor of the Glorious Church of Raleigh, located in Raleigh, North Carolina. How you doing today, Pastor Davis?
I'm doing well. I'm just so glad to be here. And it's just good to see what the Lord is doing with the platform that he's giving you.
Yeah. Pastor, I'm excited to talk to you. You and I, we do this a lot.
A lot.
So what the listeners are going to get a chance to do is hear what you and I do sometime when we talk on the phone one-on-one.
Yeah, on the regular.
Right. Mm-hmm. And that's just going to be the bouncing off of the Word of God. And when I was reading this text in Luke chapter 7, verse 36 through 48, and I saw myself in the text. I've been the individual who's gone to a party and didn't feel like I should be there or like I was in the wrong place.
Yes.
And so in this text, I feel like some of us have been the host of the party in our lives, where we've hosted parties and we've X'd out some people who we didn't think was good enough to be at the party. And then I feel like some of us have been the person that maybe we even had a friend who said, no, you can come on and be my plus one, when they know they shouldn't have made us their plus one. They knew we were going to be looked at with the side eye. However, because they were our friend, they thought that they could invite us. But when we got there, everybody else at the party looked at us with the side eye because we didn't meet a certain criteria. We didn't meet the socioeconomic status to be at the party. So when I look at Luke chapter 7, verse 36 through 48, this is kind of what we see, Pastor, is this young lady shows up at this party that Jesus was invited to by the Pharisees. And so when I look at this text, Pastor, I want you to take an opportunity to tell us, what do you think about this particular text? She shows up at this party, uninvited, but she knows Jesus is there. She shows up and has this dialogue with Jesus. And I want you to tell us about this dialogue and your take on this dialogue that happens.
I love this story, first of all, that's found in Matthew chapter 7, verses 36, really through 50. It's a story that we all can relate to. I believe that we've all been there, one or the other. We've been the host, as you said earlier, mm-hmm. and we have been the uninvited guest or invited by someone that was invited. But however, with this particular account, this lady comes in, and she is known or recognized by her shortcomings. One thing I thank God, Higgle, that he reaches beyond our fault, and he sees our need. Right. And I think that whenever we are compassionate, empathetic, consider somebody else's feelings, emotions, where they are, and we consider ourselves, that love will compel us to put on that person's shoes. And sometimes it comes at a cost. It might come at a cost to those that are there at the party, per se, that say, hold on, this person doesn't meet our criteria, but you're over there socializing with them. It really takes a person who has a heart for people that find themselves in those types of situations, but it pays heavily on the back end. Yeah. You know, Jesus, here at this story, of course, this woman comes in, and the one that was having the party, the Pharisee, he said that if Jesus was, if he was a prophet, he would have known not only who she was, but what she had done. Those two interrogative questions, which lets us know that he didn't even know about the deity, the godness that was in Jesus. He was 100% God, 100% man. But however, people tend, or we tend, if we're not careful, to judge people by their error, mistakes, miscues, or whatever. And that's not always the case.
Right. And we error in that way. And what I love is because the Pharisee had the audacity. Like, you know, that's what the young people say, the audacity. Yeah. They had the audacity. Yeah. So he had the audacity to question Jesus about his interaction with this young lady who, you know, we know that she had sins, but as do all of us,
all
right?
Of us, all
he
of
that
us.
Is without sin, let him cast the first stone.
Come on, man. We all
so
have sinned.
We all dropped the ball. We Amen. All missed the mark.
Amen.
And so he began to question Jesus about his interaction with this woman. And Jesus goes back to him and said, look, this woman, from the moment she came in, she began to wash my feet with her tears.
Wow.
Because in the custom in that day, they washed their, when you entered into someone's home, they washed your feet. Mm-hmm. Because, of course, with sandal feet, they called it, your feet were so dirty from your travels. So you can't be walking in here with your feet looking a mess. Mm-hmm. So they washed your feet. And so basically Jesus went on to say, look, she did that. She kissed me. She greeted me with a kiss. She did all these things that were customs for us that you didn't even do.
Mm.
And so in that, Pastor, when I read that, I wonder what was the Pharisee thinking in that moment, that Jesus is now calling him to the task because this woman who was the least expected, who was the one never, you know, in his eyes didn't meet the mark.
Mm-hmm.
Maybe nobody could love, nobody could appreciate. But Jesus is saying, no, I see value in her.
Mm.
She did this. She washed my feet. She kissed me. She acknowledged our customs.
Yes.
But you didn't. And so I wonder how the Pharisee thought about that. Because sometimes, Pastor Davis, what we tend to do is we think more highly of ourselves than we ought to, and we diminish the value in other people.
Mm-hmm.
And we call ourselves Christians doing that.
Come on.
But nowhere in that is that reflected in this text.
Wow.
That's not who Jesus is. That's not his love. As a matter of fact, he said, men will know that you are my disciple.
Now you have love one towards another.
There you go.
That's the evidence.
That's the evidence. And that's what he displayed in this text. So talk to me about when we encounter people who don't look like us, how do we give them Jesus, Pastor, without always having to put the cross around our neck and have the things on our wall in our office, in the workplace, or without always just having to come out of our mouth and say, hey, I'm a Christian.
Mm-hmm.
How do we show people Jesus?
I think you said earlier, we're talking about love language. I don't care wherever I might travel. I might travel from here to Russia, per se. And if I get off that plane in that other foreign country that I don't know the language, I know if you have respect, some level of love or anything, body language, what you do, if you treat someone like the way that you want to be treated, in spite of whatever barriers we might have, be it be gender, be it be race, be it be faith, love will translate somehow. And you know when you're in the presence of love. And we know what the Bible says, that for God is love. And God is always demonstrating what love is. Love is sacrificial. Love is preferring someone over yourself. Love is putting on somebody else's shoes and trying to interpret how they might be feeling in the moment. And you sacrificially meet a need that needs to be met because you have what it takes to meet that need. I think it's interesting that you also brought up when Jesus was talking about the customs. He had expectation. He was expecting certain things to take place with his feet being washed. And not only does he go on to talk to the host of the party, and he says to the host of the party, look, you did not even give me water, but this woman provided water through her tears. Not only did she didn't stop there, she dried them with her hair. And we know, symbolically, a woman's hair at this time was her glory. She was willing to take that which was her glory and dry his feet. And of course, we know where there's moisture and dirt, you're going to have mud. She didn't care how it was going to leave her looking with mud in her hair or whatever, but she didn't stop there. And I think that you might share with us later on about the perfume that she utilized, because he was once again able to look beyond her fault and see her need. How horrible is it, or how humiliating can it be to be reminded of your shortcomings, where you missed it at? You know, the scripture says that all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. All of us have come short. But however, I think that we need to be there to show that love. That scripture that you shared earlier says that by this shall all men know that you are my disciples, that you have love one towards another, that you are a pupil of mine, that you're a follower, an understudy of mine, that you love.
Ooh, Pastor, that's good. That's good. Mm-hmm. You talked about the expectation that Jesus had, that mm-hmm. because of their mm-hmm. customs.
Yes.
What his expectation was in that, what the Pharisees should have done. And what I love in that is when you recognize who I am, based on your recognition of that, then I shouldn't have to ask you to do certain things. They should be automatic.
Automatic.
Because you recognize who I am.
Yes.
So guess what? When with that love that we show people, when we recognize that people have value, then we treat people according to the value we know people have.
Yes, yes.
They may not have it all together. Yeah. But when we can see and know that people have value.
Yes, Lord. Mm-hmm.
See, we didn't always look like what we look like today.
Mm-mm.
And we're still mm-mm. works in progress,
works
right?
in progress. Amen.
So we want to treat people according to the fact that they have value. And something that I'm learning, Pastor Davis, is that everywhere I go and I encounter people, I want to add value. I pray now yes. in the mornings, every day when I get up, Lord, help me to add value today.
Yes.
To add value everywhere I go. Because guess what? If I'm not adding value, I definitely don't want to subtract it.
Amen. I'm with you.
We have to add value everywhere we go. And so when we come back, we're going to take a break, short break. And when we come back, Pastor, we're going to talk about that alabaster, that perfume that she broke and poured out on his feet.
Wow.
Can we talk about that?
I look forward to it.
So we're going to take a break, and we'll be right back. Thank you for listening.
The tears that made her blind. She felt such pain. Some spoke in anger, heard folks whisper, there's no place here for her kind. Still on she came, through the shame that flushed her face, until at last she knelt before his feet. And though she spoke no words, everything she said was heard. As she poured her love for the master from her box of alabaster, and I've come to pour my praise on him like oil from Mary's alabaster box. Don't be angry if I wash his feet with my tears and I dry them with my hair. You weren't there the night he found me. You did not feel what I felt when he wrapped his love all around me. And you don't know the cost of the oil in my alabaster box. I can't forget the way life used to be. I was a prisoner to the sin that had me bound. Poured my life without measure into a little treasure box I thought I found. Until the day when Jesus came to me and healed my soul with the wonder of his touch. So now I'm giving back to him praise he's worthy of. I've been forgiven, and that's why I love him so much. And I've come to pour my praise on him like oil from Mary's alabaster box. Don't be angry if I wash his feet with my tears and dry them with my hair. You are there the night Jesus found me. You did not feel what I felt when he wrapped his loving arms around me.
Presence of the King.
And if you're just tuning in to Healthy Soul with Coach T, I'm sitting with my guest today, Pastor Darrell Davis. Pastor Davis, say hello to the people.
Hello, hello, everybody.
And Pastor Davis is with the Glorious Church of Raleigh out of Raleigh, North Carolina. And today we are talking about the uninvited guest. When you attend a party that you weren't necessarily invited to, but you just kind of did a pop-up, if you will, and then you kind of got those strange looks. But then you met someone at the party who made time for you, who made you feel invited, who made you feel like you belong, and you left the party feeling better about yourself. You left the party feeling like life mattered. You left the party feeling like you were winning, like you could conquer the world. And so we are actually having our conversation from Luke chapter 7, verses 36 through 50. And so, Pastor Davis, we want to pick up where we left off. So during our break, we were actually talking about some transparency that was taking place in this text. So Pastor Davis, talk about the transparency that you see happening in this text.
Well, once again, in this text, I love this story, as we discussed in the first segment, but this lady gave it all. I mean, in spite of what people thought about her, in spite of what people knew about her, she realized that the one that could do something about it, the one that will take her as she was. I mean, because everybody wants to be accepted. And when they find that safe place, which that safe place is always, in someone who can give love and share love. They know what love is all about. Mm-hmm. You know, and especially when we make reference to Jesus himself, and we oftentimes quote John 3:16, where it says that so God so loved the world that he did something, that he gave, just like Jesus gave in this moment, took time for her, and he being that safe place for her, she felt that she could be totally transparent, as we saw, or we'll see later on in the parable that he gave to teach about transparency. I really believe that if we're going to go to God, that you know, the scripture says that, you know, that God desires truth on the inward parts. He desires truth on the inward parts, and if you want to be delivered of a thing, if you want to have victory in a thing, if you want to be set free from a thing, you have to be honest about the thing. And who else to be honest to but the one who's all-knowing, has all power, who's everywhere at the same time, who has always existed, who will always exist. Right. For the scripture says, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was God, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God, and the Word became flesh. So we thank God for Jesus' earthly ministry, and we thank God that he, his arms are always wide open, waiting for us to come to him, to be transparent and naked before him, because he's the only one who really, really will accept us right where we are. Amen.
Pastor. Yeah. That's it. Mm-hmm. And the thing is, that I love about this woman is that, you know, she poured out this perfume. She broke open mm-hmm. this alabaster box. And, mm-hmm. you know, the scripture refers to it as the alabaster box. Mm-hmm. And one of the things, if I could parallel that for uh-huh. a moment, uh-huh. if I could, to today, I would symbolize that, because the alabaster box was full of this expensive ointment or perfume, if mm-hmm. you will. And as a matter of fact, the people were like kind of shocked that she poured it out, and as they say, that she would waste it.
Uh-huh.
They thought she wasted it. Mm-hmm. And so I was looking up some of the most expensive perfumes last night, and I saw two that really like shocked me. Mm-hmm. And I said, I'm gonna have to see if I can find out what they smell like. But one was Symphony by Louis Vuitton, costing roughly about $530. And the other mm-hmm. one was by Clive Christian, and I can't remember the exact name of it, but it was like $850. So it would be equivalent to breaking that open and just pouring it on the ground, if you will. But if I could parallel that alabaster box, I would parallel that to breaking open the heart. Mm. Because the Bible lets us know that where your heart is, where your treasure is, there will your heart be also.
Yes.
And oftentimes, Pastor, many of us are holding things in our heart, mm-hmm. near and dear, that are precious to us.
Yes.
Those experiences that we've gone through, ideals that we have that we feel like we can't share with anyone else. Dreams and hopes,
yes.
that we have, that we feel like we may have disclosed or can't disclose with others.
Mm-hmm.
But it's those things that are in our heart and are overflowing in our heart. And I believe that when she came to Jesus, she was willing to be transparent and pour out everything in his heart. Her hopes, her dreams, her failures, mm-hmm. her desires, yeah. her traumas.
Yes.
See, we're willing to disclose a lot of stuff, but we'll keep those traumas hidden.
Mm-hmm.
We'll keep our family secrets hidden. All those things that have been hurting us for so long. I remember I heard Steve Harvey say something that was interesting. He said, you know, a lot of us, especially in Black America, mm-hmm. we've been taught that what go on in this house stays in this house.
Yes.
And he said that if it's hurting you and you 40 and 50 years, it's time to tell somebody.
Yes.
And so I believe that this woman, when she came to Jesus' feet, the reason she was able to cry so many tears, that she could drown with her hair, that she literally emptied out her heart of so many things and so many wounds and so many issues. And then, Pastor, she dried them with her hair.
Mm.
Now, Pastor, you know, for a Black woman, I'm just saying.
I know.
Culturally.
Yes.
She got to go get her hair did.
Did.
Did, not done.
No.
But did. And she dried his tears with her hair, which was symbolic of glory.
Mm-hmm.
But she dried his feet with her hair. Now, some people say, oh, I ain't touching nobody's feet. That's dirty. That's nasty. Pastor, if Jesus Look, showed up in my household in the flesh. Look, feet ain't dirty. I'm going to get down and I'm going to touch them feet. That's just the way it is.
That's how it is.
And so when I hear people say, that, oh, feet dirty, feet nasty, and all these other things. But while people say that and I get what they're saying, that's also symbolic of something. That means that we will minimize doing what we need to get what we need. To get what we need so that we can become better.
Yes.
And so my thing is, what are we willing to do? This woman broke open this expensive perfume and said, you know what? I'm going to do what I need to do. Because I know what I need to get. I'm broken. I'm hurting. As a matter of fact, I'm going to crash the whole party. She crashed the whole party.
Yes.
Showed up at the party. Said, look, I'm going to see Jesus today. It's going. I'm in here today. That's what she did. She said, I'm showing up today.
Yeah.
If he in the building, I'm in the building too. And I believe that it's that level of tenacity,
yes,
Pastor, that leads to our healing.
Mm.
Because healing is intentional. It does not happen haphazardly.
Mm-hmm.
And so we want healing sometimes to we want to pray about a thing and we want God to just heal. But the scripture says that it is he that works in us his will and to do
and
his
to do.
Good pleasure.
Yes.
So guess what? He partners with us in our healing.
Mm.
So when we praying and we asking God to heal us, then now what is required of me that I can walk in my healing? So for some of us, God is healing us of broken relationships and wrong relationships and always running into some of these knuckleheads that we run into in the streets. Let's just talk real talk. I've been on that side.
Understand.
Then guess what? Maybe part of what I need to do is set some boundaries. What is God requiring of me? He's going to partner with me for my healing. If I need healing in my physical health for high blood pressure, yes, God will heal my body. I remember, Pastor Davis, I had been diagnosed with high blood pressure. I was praying for healing, and my blood pressure went down, and I saw the Lord heal me. And then the next thing I know, about 8 months later, my blood pressure started going up again. And I said, Lord, I said, I thought you healed me. He said, I did. You forfeited your healing. I said, Lord, how did I do that? He said, because you didn't change your eating habits. So he partners with us.
Yes.
So once he heals me, what change am I willing to make? See, we want him to do all the work while we do nothing.
Change to maintain.
We got to make some changes to maintain. We just can't be lazy in our pursuit of healing or in our relationship with the Lord. We want it always to be one and done. Now, can God do that? Absolutely. He's God.
Yeah.
There's nothing he can't do. But oftentimes, God is after something. He's using our lives to witness to the world around us, to add value in a world around us. So, Pastor, if I can tell people, yes, the Lord healed me, and then he required of me to eat better. He required of me to set some boundaries in my life. He required of me to change my schedule. He required of me to set up some quality time with him.
He required. He'd give us strategy.
Yes.
He give us instruction.
Yes.
And he also says back in the book of Deuteronomy, he says that if you be willing and obedient, that you eat the good of the land. So in other words, being obedient to whatever those promptings, instructions are, when we do it, when we taste and see, then we experience the promise that's on the other side of obedience. So he'll show us the way. He told Noah the measurements. He gave him the blueprint. He had to build by those particular instructions. The same thing applies because he's concerned about every intricate detail in our lives. And when we make reference to this lady who was willing to give all and just move in transparency versus or contrast against the Pharisee in the house who, when he gets into this parable, he says that there was someone that was owed, there was two debtors, one owed five denarii and the other one 50. He asked the same one who had an issue with this woman washing his feet and breaking her box and he says to her, he says to him, he says, look, which of the two, if he forgave both, because God is not a respecter of persons.
Right, right.
He loves us equally.
Right.
He loves us. But he asks, he says, which of the one would love him more? The Pharisee himself in the parable says, I assume the one that was forgiving more would love him more. He said, you have rightly judged. Then Jesus goes in to saying that since I've been here, you haven't done this, you haven't done that. Expectation was not met. He says, but this woman has done this particular thing, this, 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 that, and the other. But what he says was that the one that has been forgiven much, he didn't say that the Pharisee had less sins than this woman's life who has been a parent. But she was so transparent that all of her sins was laid at his feet, and she was willing to have her hair dirty. She was willing to break the alabaster box. She was willing to weep tears, those same tears that's recorded that he collects our tears.
Yes.
But this individual who's standing back in judgment, this individual who's standing back in pride, this person who's sitting back probably has not confessed everything. He's not transparent before this so-called prophet, but yet the Messiah. He's not as transparent. And unfortunately, sometimes we don't take everything that we have to God. It's the place where we need to take it to. Yeah. David simply says this, against thee and thee only have I missed the mark, have I sinned. And I think that God wants us to have a habitual habit daily to live a life of repentance wherever we are. There's some things that, let me say this. I'm a proponent of counseling. I really am. The scripture says that there's safety in the multitude of counselors. And there's some things that that needs to be said just in that setting. But however, accountability is necessary.
Absolutely.
But it starts with transparency.
Yeah.
It starts with it. If we want to receive the benefits of what love and only love can bring, we have to be just that transparent before Him.
Yeah, that's good, Pastor Davis. It's one of the things that you touched on was the judgment, the judgment. And, you know, the Bible tells us, given it shall be given to you.
Mm.
Good measure, pressed down,
shaking
together, running over,
mm-hmm.
shall be given to your bosom. And we have relegated that down to just offering. But when you read the preceding text before that,
before
we quote that, he is actually talking about a measure of grace. A measure of grace. And so we want to be people of, you know, of God who, when we see the uninvited guest, when we see the person that don't look like we do in the four walls of Christendom, not just our local churches, but the four walls of Christendom.
Yes.
We want to make sure that we are exemplifying grace, not just in the four walls of Christendom, but period. We want to make sure that we're giving grace. Why? Because to whom much is given,
much is required.
And so I have been a benefactor of God's grace.
Me too.
And so because I've been a benefactor of His grace, I want to also make sure that I am giving grace to others. Because I often say this, that we as people, we tend to be top-notch judges or defense attorneys of other people's sins. But my God, we'll be good lawyers of our own. We'll do what we can to try to get ourselves out of our own.
I like that. I like that.
And so,
so true.
Here's the thing is that, you know, we all need some grace. We all need some grace. And what type of influence and impact would we have if we just took the individual, found the common ground? Because guess what, Pastor Davis? There's always a common ground. People say, well, I don't have no common ground with them. Check your pass. Check your pass. Because see, it's that common ground that'll draw you to a conversation.
Amen.
Where you can pull them forward. You don't believe me? Let's check the scriptures. When thou art converted,
strengthen your brother.
See, it's that common ground that'll draw us so that we can have something to draw them out. But we forget that. So this woman walks into the party as the uninvited guest. And the people in the room can look around at her And see, Jesus, he remembered when they said, that's Jesse's boy.
To be rejected.
See, he remembered. Because we have not a high priest who's not touched by the feeling of our infirmities. Guess what? He knows what it feels like to be rejected. He knows what it feels like to be looked down on.
Yes.
He knows. So coming through the door, I imagine she had her head hung down. I imagine she had a look of shame because she was considered a woman of the night, quote unquote, a prostitute in that day.
Mm-hmm.
They had many other names for today.
Mm-hmm.
But I imagine when she came through that door, he picked up on her countenance. Mm-hmm. He's an all-knowing God.
Mm-hmm.
And so he knew, I got time today. See, they don't have time for you, but I got time today. As a matter of fact, I am time.
Come on.
This moment was carved out for you.
Yes. This is really your part.
Oh, they thought I came for the party. No, I came for you.
Mm-hmm.
And Pastor, that's what he does. He comes for us. He comes
Thank
for
you.
Us.
I love it. I love it.
He comes for us. And so we're going to take a break. And when we come back from our break, I'm going to come back and we're going to wrap up. We're going to give Pastor Davis our final thought. And then we're going to call it a day.
Sometimes life can weigh upon your shoulders. Pressure too heavy for me to shoulder. But when I just hand it over, you take the load and make it light. Whatever's left, you make it right for me. God, for me, I find my life when I lose it in you. I gain control when I give it to you. I save myself when I let you save me. Yeah, the best thing. Best thing I can do for me is you. yeah, the best thing I can do for me is you. I ask for things that I think that I need. I get frustrated when you disagree, and you're always listening closely to me. Praying for results, I'm not hoping that it all goes exactly how I want. No, I'm not asking you to do it or asking that you don't. I'm just inviting you to my situation. Come through, 'cause I want you in my situation. I'm just inviting you. Exactly how I want. No, I'm not asking you to do or asking that you don't. I'm just inviting you to my situation. Come through, 'cause I want you in my situation. I'm just inviting you in my situation.
Welcome back to our final episode of today's segment of Healthy Soul with Coach T, where our topic is the uninvited guest. And I am sitting here today with my guest, who is Pastor Darrell Davis, the senior pastor of the Glorious Church of Raleigh, located in Raleigh, North Carolina, where he pastors right along with his wife, Lady Loretta. Pastor Davis, I am going to give you the opportunity to leave us with our final thought for today.
Well, I think this has been an awesome time to be able to come and to share and to just bounce off one another, as we always do, seem like. But this particular parable or story that's found in Luke chapter 7, verses 37 through 50, this uninvited guest, this woman who came in and shared everything with the Lord and his love for her, I think that we can extract from his example what he's done for us, that we should be mindful to try to repeat to others. We should be looking for that person who doesn't feel accepted, that doesn't feel a part, that feels ostracized, that feels rejected, that we would be agents to be able to share that love, that we always continue to, that we always seem to benefit ourselves, because he's always loving us. You know, the scripture says that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us, and he continues to love us on a daily basis. But I think that it's more pleasing to him that when we have that evidence that we was talking about earlier, where he says that, if you love me, if you love Christ, the evidence is how we treat one another.
Right.
And I think that we just need to be sensitive to what's going on now. You know, we're coming out of an epidemic. We have wars. We have all types of things that's going on. And there are pressing needs that people have. And I think that we need to be sensitive to be able to go the extra mile to love somebody in this day and time that we're going through. So I just pray that God will make us sensitive to the needs of other people.
Yeah. Sounds good. Thank you so much, Pastor Davis, for an opportunity to sit down and talk with you on air. We do this all the time, like we said, we do this all the time, so this is our norm, but an opportunity for the listeners to hear kind of what our conversations are like. We have this dialogue quite frequently about many different things in the Bible, but when I was looking at this text, you know, I knew that this would make a good discussion to have with you on the air. I want to say to the listeners that, look, you and I both, we have all been the uninvited guest at some point. And so, look, like Pastor David said, show love to others out there. People feel uninvited all the time. So we need to show love to other people whenever we have the opportunity. I always say, there's always an opportunity to add value to others. Pastor Davis, so for the listeners, how can they find the church? How can they follow on social media? Can you tell us how we can find you on social media?
Hey, well, as it has been stated earlier, we are the Glorious Church of Raleigh in the great town of Garner, North Carolina, at exit 312, Highway 42, 130, Commerce Parkway. Hey, we look forward to seeing you. Our services are at 10:30 on Sundays, every Sunday. We have an awesome time in praise and worship. Well, look, we love the word. We don't mind worshiping, and we don't mind doing that work. And you'll find imperfect people in pursuit of a perfect God. Look, we look forward to seeing you when you are in this region. Look, peace and love.
Did y'all hear Pastor Davis? Pastor Davis, no, this is what we do. But he know I got to go out with a laugh. Did y'all hear Pastor Davis say the word, the worship, the word, and we don't mind doing the work? Y'all didn't know he could bust a rap like that, did you? But anyway, thank y'all so much for listening. If you're not following me, you can follow me on Instagram at Simplistic Solutions RLC, also on Facebook at Simplistic Solutions RLC. And until our next episode, deuces.
Record. I still have a blemished heart. I don't have much worth without you. I am good because you are. Take this lump of clay and build yourself a place in it. Make a cathedral out of me. 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 say, but you still listen when I sing. Take this lump of pain and make yourself an instrument. Make a cathedral out of me. 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 Oh, you'll see the light in the dark. You make a temple inside of my heart. You see the saint inside.